Top of the morning to you, everybody. I'm not Pastor Steve. he couldn't make it, and luckily I could, so it's good to be with you this morning. And those of you that are wearing blue are also celebrating, and you'll hear about that in the children's sermon if they come forward today. Today's live stream broadcast is given by the members of Salem Lutheran Church. And there are other announcements in your bulletin, which is so well prepared all the time. Next Sunday is Passion Sunday / Palm Sunday. It's the roller coaster of emotions Sunday. Please remember to pick up your palm before entering the sanctuary, and there will be opportunity during worship to process to lay the palm at the foot of the cross. So it'll be a very, very nice celebration. And everybody's alive and well. I don't think I didn't pass a single car coming today until I got to Lake Mills. No, nobody is out today. Okay, please stand for the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who writes the law on our hearts, who draws all people together through Jesus. Amen. Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts. We let hurts grow into hatred. For all these things and for sins only you know, forgive us, Lord. Amen. Here is a flood of grace. Out of love for the whole world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life through Jesus Christ. Amen. Steadfast love, you draw us to yourself, and in mercy you receive our prayers. Strengthen us to bring forth the fruits of the Spirit, that through life and death we may live in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated, and I invite the children to come on down. Children, well, if you don't come down, I'm going to say something anyway. I know there are more of you out there. Yeah, come on.
go on the other side. I don't want to forget this time. Always forget this. So where's your green today?
Huh? I don't like the color green.
You don't? It was my mother's favorite color. And she's got green eyes. A little while ago, I took a DNA test. You know what that is? You send that in and it tells you what your background is. And I found out that I have a little Irish in me. So I could celebrate. I'm going to go home and have corned beef and cabbage. Do you like that? Good. Not everybody does. I do. I love it. Well, do you know anything about St. Patrick? Do you know he wasn't really a saint? The people liked him so much that they really made him a saint, but the church never really canonized him as an official saint. But that's okay. People like to party, so we celebrate him. But do you know it wasn't always green? You said you don't like green. The color used to be blue for Ireland, because Henry VIII was the one who was in Ireland, and his color was blue. So blue was the celebration color for Ireland for a while, okay? But way back then, Patrick was captured by pirates. How do pirates sound? Arr! Yes. Okay, everybody do arr! Ah, good, aren't they good? So Patrick was captured by pirates and sent to Ireland, because he was really from England, okay? And a lot of people, we have a legend. You know what a legend is? It's a made-up story, right? People like to think that Patrick was the one who chased all the snakes out of Ireland. But we think that it was the climate, really, that kept the snakes out of Ireland. And Alaska doesn't have snakes either because of the climate. How about that? Okay. Well, anyway, he was sent to Ireland, and from there he proclaimed the gospel and spread the gospel all over Ireland. He was eventually ordained. It's because he wasn't a priest when he first went over there, but he became a deacon and then a priest, and he spread the gospel message, and that's what he's best known for. Let me see what else I want to tell you here. What do they do in Chicago? Do you know what they do today for St. Patrick's Day? That's kind of neat. They turned their big river green. Yeah, they put dye in it. Green River. And there was big St. Patrick's Day in parade in New York City. That was yesterday. And I lived in Cleveland for a while. They have a big St. Patrick's Day parade too. New York City parade has been going on since 1762. Could you imagine that? With 150,000 marchers. Wow, that's a big celebration. Okay, well, also another legend with St. Patrick is that he's the one that made that three-leaf clover, the shamrock, the image of the Trinity. We don't think he really did that either, but that's okay. That's really okay. And then he says, I am certain in my heart that all that I am, I have received from God, and that he really was, okay? But the bishop sent him to Ireland, and he studied in France and became a priest, and then he went back to Ireland and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a good story, way back when. So you could wear blue to celebrate, and you could wear green to celebrate, okay? Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for your children, Lord, and we like when they come to church. We ask that you increase their faith, and we bless the families too that make sure they do come to church, and bless all the teachers that are strengthening their faith. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And you can have fake candy, because it's really fruit, I think, right? Pretty neat. Oh, you're welcome. Okay, we continue with the readings. I got to take this so I know the prayers.
A Our first reading this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 31, beginning with verse 31. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors and then took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Psalms today is be read responsibly, beginning with the lecture, and it's from Psalm 51, beginning with verse 1. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. In your great compassion, blot out my offenses.
Wash me through and through from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my offenses, and my sin is ever before me.
Against you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so you are justified when you speak and right in your judgment.
Indeed, I was born steeped in wickedness, a sinner from my mother's womb.
Indeed, you delight in truth deep within me and would have me know wisdom deep within.
Remove my sins with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be purer than snow.
Let me hear joy and gladness, that the body you have broken may rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my wickedness.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with your beautiful spirit.
Our second reading is from Hebrews chapter 5, beginning with verse 5. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, was appointed by the one who said to him, You are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John, the 12th chapter. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them,
The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. There was an unusual message on my Facebook page last week. A pastor colleague in Northeast Ohio wrote how upset she was that it was so warm already. She said she wished the sprouting plants would stay in the ground a while longer. She did not want to rush the season. I know my lilac bush is blossoming already. Well, I am thrilled when I see the new growth coming from seeds and bulbs that I planted. I was never known for having a green thumb. The hyacinths and daffodils are beautiful. I even have herbs popping out of the ground from last year's planting. And it looks as though I might have some berries this year. It's a garden resurrection, and I certainly don't mind that it's early this year. We'll have to wait and see what April has in store for us. It might snow for Easter. Today's gospel story is a favorite for funeral services, especially those at the graveside. Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground, it has no chance of becoming anything greater than itself. When the person dies, his body returns to the elements of nature, but a new person blossoms in heaven. Jesus, of course, is predicting his own death and resurrection. But in John's gospel, Jesus never says anything simply, you know. He speaks in pictures, in metaphors, in words similar to those of the picturesque Hebrew language. Once again, Jesus is giving his disciples, including all of us, hope. He's telling us that, yes, we must confront death, but the seeds of our earthly beings will grow into something more wonderful afterwards. This is the power of God's word, the word that heals, the word that promises, the word that reassures. Now, I doubt if Philip and Andrew were reassured by Jesus' words. They probably were just as befuddled as their Greek friends who had come to see Jesus. Consider the response of Jesus to their request. Well, if you want to see me, look to the ground and look to the cross. Look down and look up. When I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself. Jesus takes all our sins, all our burdens, all our worries, and lifts them up with him on the cross. And poof, they disappear. They are forgotten. So lay it all on Jesus. He can take it. That's why he came, and that's what he does. Children carry burdens of guilt around with them that we adults aren't always aware of. It is a big relief when they discover that their parents, their friends, and their fellow Christians have experienced the very same burdens. And sometimes you learn this many, many years later. When I was a child, my sister and I used to play funeral in the autumn leaves. I know, I was a weird kid. I was always playing priest. One day I pretended that my father was buried beneath the leaves and conducted his funeral service. And then he died of a heart attack, 39 years old. He caught pneumonia in the hospital following his second heart attack at the age of 39. And I don't know how much time had passed since I had played funeral, but for many, many years I thought I had killed my father. I thought God had mistakenly understood that I wanted my father to die. My father and I were very close, and I loved him very much. Years later, when I had to participate in group therapy as part of my seminary training, I learned that mine was not an uncommon belief among children. What a relief that was for me. Today I can chuckle and say how arrogant I was to think that God would listen to my silly ideas. One day in my Bible study class, the group discussed the raising of Lazarus. The honest grief of Jesus over the death of his friend is one of the most moving passages in the New Testament. Jesus didn't zap my father and strike him dead, as I thought. Jesus grieved with me and my young mother, who was only 32, and sister, who was 7. Jesus wept. It's so good to learn that other people share your sins, your experiences, your heartbreaks. That's what Bible study has always done for me and continues to do for me. We are not as unique as we might think. Most people around the world want the same things: peace, love, food and shelter, and the means to be content. We are one bread, one body. Once in a while, something happens that makes me wonder what our world is coming to. You might think that today, of course. Maybe people do desire war and violence. That's a big issue in the Middle East today, isn't it? I remember, you know, I got my PhD in Buffalo, New York, and in the history department, we had a large Jewish population among the faculty, and this was in the 90s, and the Jews there really would have fought with all their might to be the only state in the Middle East. I don't know what they feel today. I wonder if it's a little bit different. But violence always seems to get people excited. Peace is boring. The popularity of the movie Hunger Games is stirring up the lust for violence in the hearts of many young people. It's still available today. The media and the advertising industry have jumped on the profitable bandwagon in an attempt to make the movie a cult, and it somewhat is. The movie is about young people trying to survive in a cruel world. They must use violence in order to outlast the others. What makes this so horrible for me is that so many people are finding joy and excitement in that series. Jesus asks us to enter richly into the lives of others, to empty ourselves as he did on the cross for us. Is it too late? Is it too late to do what Jesus asks of us, to promote peace instead of violence, to love one another instead of killing one another, to think of God's creatures as one bread, one body, instead of isolating ourselves into little islands? Remember the prayer of Jesus right before he died, that we all might be one. Amen. We are. Now, as one community of faith, all bound together by the cross, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the prayers.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. God of the covenant, through the church you draw us into community. We give thanks for the means of grace around which we gather. Inspire writers, musicians, and artists whose creative gifts adorn our worship. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all that exists, you lavish the earth with extravagant beauty. Preserve the rich and complex diversity of living things. Support local, national, and international efforts to protect the environment for the future generations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the nations, you desire peace and plenty for all people. Defend those who challenge oppression and expose corruption. Support advocates for human rights, social justice, and the welfare of children. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of goodwill, you restore what is broken. We pray for any experiencing estrangement and conflict or abuse in families and intimate relationships. Protect and comfort all who are vulnerable, especially those living in institutions. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of every time and place, you are with us. Support ministries of prayer and presence in this congregation. Move us to reach out to any who are homebound, lonely, grieving, in treatment, or ill. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of promise, we give thanks for the saints whose faith inspires us, especially Patrick, missionary to Ireland, whom we commemorate today. Grant us faith to trust in your everlasting love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Pray for the families of Matthew, Jennifer, Chance, Hope, Madison, and Claire Levine, Darren, Becky, and Gavin Liverson, and Ava Klevish, Katrina, Deshaun, Tatiana, Deshaya and Tanaya Linen, Allison, Ashley, and Tiffany Lindquist, Dwayne and Hadley Lindquist. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace.
us pray. Jesus, you are the bread of life and the host of this meal. Bless these gifts that we have gathered, and that all people may know your goodness. Feed us not only with this holy food, but with hunger for justice and peace. We pray this in your name. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And now let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Bread for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. Come and eat.
Thank you.
stand. Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat are gathered into one bread, now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace. Amen. Lift high that cross.